Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Steve Van Buskirk, representing the Veterans of Foreign Wars, VFW National Headquarters. Please rise, remove your cover. Veterans, you may salute, if you so choose, for the presentation of our colors by Ruskin and East High School's JROTC. Captain of the Guard, present the colors. Cassandra Dickinson will now sing our national anthem, which will be followed by the invocation given by U.S. Army Chaplain Major Mark Morgan.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the
Let's pray. Father, I come to you today asking for your presence in this place. As we remember those who've given so much for our great nation, we honor those who paid the ultimate price by giving their lives for the cause of freedom. We pray that you would bless their families, heal the minds, the hearts, and the lingering wounds of the many who have suffered in their service to our nation. Let us look to you for direction in our lives and for peace in our time. We pray that you would grant wisdom to our leaders. Be with us now as we honor our heroes from the birth of our nation until this moment in history. I ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You may be seated. This morning you may have noticed an empty chair near the stage. This chair symbolizes members of the profession of arms who are missing from our midst. They are commonly called POWs or MIAs, but many of us call them brothers. Prisoners of war are soldiers who are captured and taken prisoner by the enemy and never repatriated during times of war. All too often, these casualties are forgotten. Sadly, the same can be said of those who are missing in action. Today, we will remember them as Don Redding will place the POW MIA chair cover that represents all soldiers that are unaccounted for. Don was a flight engineer gunner on a B-24 bomber flying out of Italy during World War II. On his 17th mission, his plane was hit by anti-aircraft fire over Vienna, Austria, and he and his crew of 10 bailed out and became part of the 90,000 airmen captured in the European theater. On April 9, 1942, one of the darkest days in American history, 70,000 Americans surrendered to the Japanese in the Philippines. When World War II ended, there were over 120,000 American prisoners of war. Today, there are only a little more than 6,000 living. Since World War II, there have been over 10,000 additional POWs to this date. At this time, Don Redding will place the POW MIA cover over the vacant chair to commemorate the lives of those who suffered the hardships of a POW, signifying that they will not be forgotten. Ladies and gentlemen, if you are physically able, please rise for the placement of the POW MIA chair covering, which will be followed by 30 seconds of silence. Please be seated. Now please welcome Brian Alexander, President and Chief Executive Officer of the National World War I Museum, to the podium.
Thank you, Steve, and good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Board of Trustees and the staff of the National World War I Museum, I'd like to welcome you to today's Veterans Day ceremony. We're pleased that you could join us today as we pause to honor all the brave men and women who have served our country. Whether they've served on the front lines or behind the scenes, in conflicts past or present, during times of war or peace, all of our veterans deserve our sincerest gratitude. It's because of their courage, their patriotism, their honor, and their sacrifice that we're able to enjoy all the freedoms we have today. At this time, I would like to ask all veterans in the audience to please stand so that we can thank you for your service. Thank you. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Congressman Emanuel Cleaver to the podium.
Although we don't say it enough, I do think that it is appropriate for us to express great appreciation to Brian Alexander and his entire staff for continuing to make this memorial one of the most significant places on our landscape. And I will say to you again, we are still struggling to get the World War I Liberty Memorial designated by Congress as the World War I Memorial. And 2 years ago, we did get it out of the committee, and before the full House, we were able to get it approved with only one dissenting vote out of 435, and it was sent to the Senate, and we were not able to get it through the Senate, but we have about 22 days remaining in this year, during which we will lobby very, very, very hard to get this declaration, which frankly we should have gotten years ago. Veterans Day at the Liberty Memorial brings a historical patriotic reminder of what this day really means. It was at the end of World War I, the armistice had been signed, and here in our nation's heartland, grateful citizens reached deep into their pockets and in just 10 days raised the money to construct this monument, lest the ages forget. The Liberty Memorial stands with its eternal flame to remind all Americans that life, liberty, and freedom come at a high cost that should be remembered and respected. We've not forgotten that generation of Americans who first landed in France on July 3rd, 1915, and first Americans shot on October 23rd, 1917. They joined the battle in the trenches alongside Allied forces. They fought with honor, patriotism, and courage, with many making the ultimate sacrifice. On November 11th, 1918, at the 11th hour of the 11th day, the armistice was signed and is remembered on every Veterans Day. Our soldiers returned home, different men who had experienced the ugliness of war and the loss of their friends. In that short time frame, heartbreakingly, 53,402 Americans were killed in combat, with a total loss of 116,516 dying in that war effort. Today, we are here on the 11th day of the 11th month of the year 2011. And as I look out among those of you who come on this patriotic day, I see patriotic veterans who are our nation's heroes, who serve to protect this great nation and ensure our freedom. Many of you have been called to battle the enemy over the years, and some of you safeguarded our peace, but like generations before, all have served. From the oldest to the youngest American, we owe you our admiration, gratitude, and appreciation. We thank you. If you've not participated in the Veterans Historic Project, or History Project, I would encourage you to do so and take the time to record your military service for future generations through this wonderful program that was unanimously passed by Congress in 2000 and signed into law by President Bill Clinton. Americans, not the least of whom would be your unborn descendants, can learn about your war experience. So many of you left your childhood with graduation from school and joined or were drafted into the military. Each war experience is different, but all the recordings tell of an individual who served with distinction, valor, and love for country. To the veterans present, again, I say thank you for a job well done. By the end of this year, our military will return home from Iraq. As they return, painfully, even tragically, many of them will be facing the uncertainties of a bad economy, a shortage of jobs, and a process of becoming reacclimated to civilian life. Yesterday, something happened that was significant. I have this philosophy that I have shared in Washington and even on national news shows. Watching the Nature Channel National Geographic. I watch all of the animal shows to the dismay of my family. But I can't help it. I'm just almost addicted to it. And in watching a special on bees, which I know all of you will probably want to go out and buy, and it's only $49.95, if you will see something that is amazing, that bees are so well organized. I mean, they actually are organized, and they are also live in a stratified world. But the one thing I came away with after watching them is that bees cannot sting and make honey at the same time. It is something that we don't have enough of in Washington, but I'm here to report that yesterday, for the first time in a long time, Congress made honey. Now, they may go back to stinging again next week, but yesterday they made honey. In a unanimous vote in the Senate, a bill is now on its way to the House, which would provide tax credits for returning veterans to get a job. Businesses who hire veterans will get a tax cut or a tax break or a tax cut credit. If you hire an individual who is among the long-term employed, the tax credit is greater. And so while the super committee is unable to get anything else done because of stinging, yesterday we made honey. And I'm here to report that it was made for veterans. To the veterans, thank you for your service. May God bless you, your families, and our great nation.
Now for his remarks, please welcome Kansas City Mayor, the Honorable Sylvester James, to the podium.
Good morning. It is my great pleasure to join you today to commemorate and to remember all those who have served our country. It's appropriate that we gather here at our nation's World War I monument on this particular day, because on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the guns lining the bloody trenches that scarred Europe ceased. The world exhaled after being submerged in what was called the Great War. It was the war to end all wars. If only that turned out to be true. So of all the places in America, on this day, this is the exact place to pause and remember. There is none like it in the world. Kansas City built this monument on this hill so that we would never forget the cost of freedom to those who died in its service. So imagine what it must have looked like in 1926 before City Hall was built, and this was the tallest structure in Kansas City. Think of the message that it sent to those who served on the bloody fields of Europe. And then imagine the message conveyed to those men and women who served during World War II and left from this very spot in the country to do so. Nearly half, and I repeat, nearly half of all of those who served in World War II traveled right through Kansas City, right through Union Station,